my name is Woody. This is Change in the House of Pods, a podcast about Deftones. This is a Dia de los Deftones special, one of two special episodes this weekend. And here, my guest is Jeremiah Kima. Jeremiah is a Sacramento native and a lifelong Deftones fan, making his first trip to Dia this year. He and I have been in conversation over Instagram for some time now, and he is never short on interesting, thoughtful things to say about our favorite band. He's a tattoo artist and a musician. In fact, you can hear some demos he's done at the beginning of a couple episodes of this podcast, like the season 3 finale with Sean Lopez. And he's a little bit younger than me. Shit, quite a bit younger. But it's for that reason in particular that I'm always curious to hear and really appreciate hearing what he thinks. I also feel like he's always got some baddies around. Like when I see him on Instagram, he's never pulling up short, you know what I mean? It's big dick energy. I'm not afraid to say it. Game recognized game. This is my conversation with Jeremiah Kima.
Well, let's jump into Dia, since this is going to be a Dia special. And being your first Dia, what are your expectations? What are you looking for specifically from Deftones?
I mean, the biggest thing that like I'm excited about is I feel like they pull out, like they always pull out like a couple deep cuts, but I think like it's, you know, anything goes when they play there. Like the set lists I've seen, some of the stuff they've played, it's just, they're going to probably pull out something that's going to surprise me. And I've seen them probably like, you know, I don't even know how many times, and it's, they always throw in like one that surprises me at least. But like this, I feel like, I mean, I've just heard the sequencing, the way that, you know, some of the tracks they pull out, like it's just, I just know that part of it's going to be exciting, and I'm excited to see what they play, you know?
Yeah, totally. I think that that's probably what a lot of fans, especially first time Dia goers,
yeah,
like yourself, or like saw that last year's set and you were like, yeah, I need to get out for that one. Am I right?
Yeah. No, it's, I mean, I'm interested to see, cause I saw videos and stuff of like the previous years, but from what I understand, it's now moved inside of the stadium, yeah, or something.
That's correct? What it looks like. Yeah. That's what it looks like.
Or it was outside of it. Correct.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so, this year it looks like there's, like a big catwalk and like a center stage, like in the middle of the,
yeah, yeah,
the floor. I mean, maybe, is that what,
I don't know, man. I mean, I've never even been to that, you know, venue, so
yeah,
I'm pretty sure it's like for baseball games or something, so like
yeah it's where the,
and
Padres,
I think,
play.
A lot more people bought tickets this year. I mean, we've talked about this many times before, but like, you know, they're definitely on a huge upswing right now. I think, you know, it's seeming like the numbers that they pulled for the previous years, people were kind of saying that now they're able to maybe move it into, you know, have it be even bigger. And like, I just know from buying tickets and how quick those went.
Yeah.
And I could imagine what the capacity is, you know.
Right. Yeah. Inside the ballpark.
They, yeah, literally, totally. They were gone within like 5 minutes, at least on my side. That's what it looked like. I got tickets and then I saw people already commenting like 2 minutes later, they're already gone. And I was, yeah, just like, Jesus Christ. All right.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, I was really surprised that it sold out last year. So this year I felt like I was, sort of anticipating it, but also like, they're not going to sell out 2 years in a row. And Turnstile was super hot. So I did,
well,
sort,
yeah,
of feel like there was some momentum from Turnstile, but Turnstile not being on the bill this year, I was like, man, how is this going to sell out?
I mean,
sure as hell did.
Who knows? Like, a Knock Loose is obviously super hot. That 100 Gex group, I mean, I'm not the most familiar with them. I do know they kind of, you know, have a decent following. I've seen they've done stuff with like, you know, bigger pop acts, I'm pretty, yeah, sure, if I'm not, yeah, mistaken. But then like, you know, you have Ryle, which is like almost like this doomier converge type stuff. You have Capra, which is like almost like a female fronted Every Time I Die, but like with some other stuff mixed in there. Dochi, you know, the rapper, which I do know has a pretty decent following. You know, and then there's just like some of the other artists, you know, I think it's just crazy that, because I mean, you know, in prior years, like they had like Future, Mike Shinoda, they had Doja Cat, they had Megastallion. It's like, I don't know.
There was no like super big second name this year. It
I
didn't
mean,
feel
yeah,
like there was some
knock.
anybody that was, even Doja Cat though, was she was hella,
Well,
she
she
was
was
like the
small back then.
first.
Yeah. This
But
was
yeah, but
before, like, you know,
so who is that person on this bill? Like, who's the one that's about to blow?
I don't know, dude. I just think it's a super heavy lineup with like a couple rappers and then like a hyper pop group, you know.
Yeah.
Like it's the heaviest lineup, I'd say. Ryle
For
Capra,
sure.
Knocked Loose, you know what I mean? Like
Totally.
knock I mean Knocked Loose is, I mean, they've been on the upswing. They've been blowing up for the past however many years, you know what I mean? And like they're only getting bigger, and they're, you know, them and Turnstile are definitely two bands that are breaking the boundaries of like bringing hardcore into the mainstream, you know what I
Totally.
mean? Like I
Totally.
had my cousin the other day be like, dude, that Turnstile band's sick, you ever heard of them? And I'm like, dude, yeah, I remember them like playing, you know, shows to like 20 people in, you know, the Bay Area and stuff around here, you know what I mean? And like
Yeah.
obviously, you know, I always knew they had like a fun groove and stuff, and like it kind of almost reminded me of this like Beastie Boys energy over hardcore, and it was just super fun. And I knew that they were going to be big in the
Where?
hardcore scene, and they always were pretty hot. But to see what they've done now, I mean, I don't know. I've seen people compare their newest record to like the impact that Nevermind had on the industry when the time when it came out. I don't know
Whoa.
how much that is to be true. That's pretty bold, I feel, but to even have somebody consider saying something like that, you know, I mean, shouts out to them, and
Yeah.
they're an incredible live act, you know.
Yeah,
So
no question. Yeah, that's they definitely are. And it's interesting too that you put Knocked Loose alongside of them. And I don't think that you're wrong in terms of bringing
yeah.
heavy music outside or to the masses. I guess with Knocked Loose too, like they're a band that I've seen a bunch. And so I guess I'm not, maybe I just that impact or that consideration has
Yeah.
sort of softened on me, or maybe what isn't is not quite lost, but it wasn't right there. But I think you're absolutely right. That's totally true.
I mean, they're two different genres, obviously. They're two, or not two different
Oh, for
genres, but
sure.
two completely different, like sonic, you know, sounds
Yeah.
and everything. Like, Knock Loose is obviously very aggressive, angry, and stuff. But I mean, you know, they've had some crazy opportunities happen to them. I mean, I remember seeing like an interview of them talking about how crazy it was that Code Orange was touring with Deftones and System of a Down, and they're like, you know, that's like what we want to do. We want to do stuff like that. And then like look at what they're doing. Like I saw Knocked Loose, and I want to say it was like 2014, opening for a five bill act, and the headliner was like a mid-level band, and nobody knew who they were. And just to see how far they've come, like I've seen them tour with that band since, and they headlined over them. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just
Yeah.
they're headlining over bands like Terror, who've been doing it for so long. You know what I mean? And it's just the
Are they
impact that they
sec?
have.
Are they second on the bill? Are they
Oh,
second on the
they're
Dia bill?
direct support, it looks like. Yeah. It looks like they're direct support. And
Damn, that's
like
gonna
it's
be
insane. You
crazy.
know what I
That's
mean?
I mean, that's gonna be that's a heavy ass set before
Oh,
Deftones go
dude.
on.
Yeah, I mean, you know, but it's like Deftones isn't scared of that. I just saw them with
Oh.
Gojira, you know. It's like
Yeah.
they
Yeah,
don't
that's not a
care.
problem. I'm not suggesting it's gonna be a
Oh
problem,
no.
but
But it's
fans are definitely
cool.
gonna be
It's
thrown a
cool
little
that like
bit.
Deftones does that. Like they're
For
not, you know,
sure.
there's bands you see in interviews talk about like, you know, you don't want to follow that. Like they're heavier. You don't want to follow that. There's so much energy, but like I love the Deftones. Like they don't give a shit. You know what I mean? Like if they like the band and they might be something as insane live as Gojira, and they're just like, bring them out. Like we don't even care if people think that we do better than them. Like they crush, and let's bring them out because they're an incredible band. You know what I mean? Like I feel
Totally.
like they bring out bands that they just want to watch every night.
Yeah.
So it's like,
Yeah.
you
I
know,
don't
same
think you're
with
wrong
this
at
whole
all.
festival. It's like, you know, they're clearly just curating acts that they enjoy, and it's like that's the sickest thing, honestly, because that's always what I feel like they've been about. They're the biggest fans of music, you know, and that's where I feel like I relate with them the most, you know.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, it's really fun to see and learn about the like where these choices come from and like who's picking what bands. Cause I think we automatically assume like, oh, Steph's picking the heavy one. Steph likes that. But he didn't just come up with Ryle. You know what I mean? Like there was some, I'm excited to learn and eager to learn. Or like with Pinback, you know, that's obviously a Deftones choice. Like that's,
oh yeah, I mean,
that's a buddy pick for sure. Like how did that happen?
Yeah.
I want to hear
that. Was like
that,
a cult, you know, kind of a cult underground indie-ish following, and like, you know, but they slightly had, you know, not like roots, I would say, but I feel like there was a lot of people in like hardcore and stuff that I knew that liked them and stuff, like
word,
that really are like into them. And they're just one of those, they're like a band's band, I feel, in a sense of like they're just one of those bands that didn't get like quite as big as I feel like they deserved. And I mean, similar with like, I feel like Deftones is finally getting like recognition that they deserved, even though, yeah, like you can argue that sure they got MTV play, sure they got whatever, but during that time era, like they were seen as like, you know, band's band, like they were like lower on the popularity scale, but
for sure,
obviously that's because they just did their own thing and not everybody understood like what they were doing, because it wasn't as flashy, it wasn't as like upfront and like, you know, as in your face and on, you know, I don't know,
as
it's
new.
On the nose is like a lot of nu metal and stuff like that.
Word.
Like, I shouldn't even just lump them in with nu metal, but like, yeah, stuff like Korn and stuff like that that was coming out at the time, it was just so on the nose, and that's what people were eating up. And then people either vibed with Deftones or they were like, you know, I would talk to people when I was younger and I'm like, you know, why don't you know, check this band out, and they're like, I don't really, you know, understand this or whatever. And I'm like, I mean, when I was at a really young age, I don't think I quite understood it, obviously, like definitely not to the level now, but I knew there was something about it that I vibed with, you know. And I think that later on in my life, as I got older, started getting more experience with music, playing shows myself, being exposed to so much different music, and just I just feel like I started to appreciate them more and more as the years go on. And there's still stuff I find myself appreciating about them that I haven't before. And I think that's just a testament to their longevity and like how they played it so smart with writing songs that they cared about, you know. And it's just, it's insane to see from when I was like 5 or 6 about first feeling like I heard them and like kind of getting into them, but obviously being too young to know why the hell I liked them so much. I just liked how it sounded, you know.
Word.
But it's just but now where they're at, it's been insane. Like
You were 5 or 6 years old when you first started listening to Deftones, is that right? Five or six?
Yes.
Tell me how you started, when do you recall, and how do you recall getting into Deftones or hearing about Deftones? I know 5 or 6 is like,
I mean, yeah,
it's a pretty tough one, but
it's, I think, you know, my mom, my dad, like really just kind of listening to, they've always been into like rock and stuff. And, you know, my mom was always listening to whatever was contemporary at the time, you know, like, she liked stuff like she loved Linkin Park. She loved Papa Roach. She loved System of a Down. She loved stuff like that. Like my dad was into like Metallica and like, you know, a lot of 80s hair metal and stuff. You know, my earliest memory is me sitting on my dad's shoulders at a Def Leppard concert at the amphitheater.
No,
yeah. So it's like, I was always exposed to stuff like that growing up. And then, you know, I would hear stuff on the radio and, you know, just in the car, and I would just enjoy it, you know. And I just remember like when I would first start buying like cassettes and stuff, I mean, obviously like I begged my mom for like this boombox thing so I could play cassettes, because I wanted to listen to like NSYNC and Britney Spears, and you know, like I wanted to bump that shit in the backyard, like Backstreet Boys, like that was the shit, you know what I mean? And then like once I started getting into, you know, that started expanding and stuff, and then CDs were becoming more of like a thing. I just remember, you know, hearing bands and just being like, I would ask people like, who is this? You know, who is this? And like try and figure it out. And then I would like beg for that CD or beg for whatever. And like, I mean, I remember hearing My Own Summer and like Be Quiet and Drive. You know, somebody was playing it at a very young age, and I was like, what is this? You know, I really like it. It's, you know, and I had heard those songs like over and over. Whoever was around at the time was just playing it, and I just remember hearing them. And then you know, Change, I started hearing that song like when I was six. It was 2000, so I was six when White Pony came out, and Change and Digital Bath, like somebody had that record, and you know, they were playing that all the time and stuff. And then I just remember hearing these songs and being like, I really like this stuff, but like I don't know, you know, how to get a hold of it or whatever.
Yeah.
And then I remember my brother went to, well, let me backtrack. So I asked for three CDs in like the year 2000 to 2001, somewhere around there. It was like Christmas, my birthday. I can't exactly remember, but it was Linkin Park, Hybrid Theory, White Pony, and then I believe Iowa by Slipknot or the self-titled, something like that. Can't exactly remember. But I do remember White Pony being in there and Hybrid Theory for sure, because I was super into Linkin Park, loved them. But yeah, and then just started listening to them more and more. And then my brother went to an Ozfest and he saw Deftones, and he brought back, this was a couple years later, he brought back the self-titled, and I was like, okay, I need more of this, you know. So I'm 9, 10 at this point,
Yeah.
and I'm just vibing with all that, you know. And it's just I kind
Wow.
of followed it, and then he got Adrenaline after that. He's like, oh, this is their first album. And then I was like, oh, what is this shit? And then I was like, this is way different sounding than like White Pony and self-titled. And I was like, this is tight, you know. So we just listened to that shit all the time, and it was just, we would just listen to them and like play PS2 and shit all the time. And and then after that, I remember Saturday Night Wrist came out, and that was kind of like around the time that like MySpace had started like kind of popping off or whatever. At least I think that was around the time, at
Yeah,
least the
for
time that I
sure.
started getting on it, because what, that was 2006.
Yeah.
And I remember initially not really understanding it. I remember really liking Beware and Cherry Waves
Same, but you were 12.
right off the bat. Yeah, exactly. But you know, I was like, why do I like all their other stuff so much? But this is like weird to me, because it was like I still liked self-titled and stuff, you know, and that was a departure from White Pony and Around the Fur.
Sure.
But now it's my favorite record by them, you know. So it's like, it's funny
Yeah.
how that happens. And it, you know, it took years to get to that point, but it's just, it's crazy how that happens. But that goes back to their longevity and them making decisions at certain times musically or sonically, and you know, them reaping the benefits later for it. Because you look at kids now, I mean, their Saturday Night Wrist stuff is all over like TikTok, and you know, there's so many people that know that album. Like I wear a shirt around with that album cover on it, and like I have people like, dude, that's my favorite album, and they're like 17, 18, and I'm like, dude, nobody would have said this like 5 to 10 years ago. Like it's crazy. So
It really is crazy. It's crazy that it's your favorite album too. I think that that's great, especially, having discovered it. I think it's really fun too that you're basically like a preteen or budding teenager at the precipice of the advent of MySpace and Deftones dropping this weird ass record that your son actually prepared for, like, because you have since. Basically been you since you were a baby have been listening to heavy music, which is kind of fun. And I think about all of that, like that whole recipe is really, it's really interesting to me, because it's kids that are that age now that are, like you said, connecting with that album and with all of that music from that time. I mean, shit, NSYNC is coming back.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it's
that whole era. '90s to mid 2000s, like that.
The TRL era is totally like it's wild.
It's back in full force.
All of its splendor. It's too bad Carson Daly isn't like more of a central figure. I feel like we should really, lift him up and center his voice in some way, because without Carson, I feel like he was like the sun, like all of that shit orbited around Carson. It's really,
I mean, at any wrong.
Rate. At any not rate. Wrong. So if Saturday Night Wrist is your favorite album, is your favorite song on that album?
I just threw a fastball, corner pocket. There was years where I would have said Knife Party.
Word.
Even with it being, I don't know, dude, that's hard, because I feel like it can change sometimes. I think it just depends on like where I'm at in my life to a certain degree. I mean, Kim Dracula is definitely very high up there. That song, see, like initially when I heard it, I just remember thinking the title was like super tight. I just remember thinking it, for whatever reason, I just remember thinking it was like the coolest title. But like not necessarily thinking the song is as good as something like Beware, Cherry Waves, or like Hole in the Earth, or, you know, some of the other stuff on the record. But then like, and then I started to like really like it and stuff, but then I saw it live, that they did one of those things. They pulled it out the gates. Like they just pulled it out of the woodworks. Like I was not expecting it. And I was like, oh, they're playing Kim Dracula, sick. And then he played it live and I was just in a trance the whole time. And I was like, holy shit, this just skyrocketed to my top five, you know? And it's like, it's crazy that sometimes like seeing a live act, like if it's put in that perspective, it can change the way that you feel about a song on record.
Totally. Totally. I couldn't agree more. It can, it rarely does it make it worse, but it definitely, like, if you love a song, or if you feel sort of, if you're mid on a song and you hear it great live, it's like, turns it up to a whole. That's really awesome. I feel like Kim Dracula was one that I really loved from Saturday Night Wrist, like out the gate. And I didn't love Saturday Night Wrist out the gate. I feel like I was caught up in all of the drama of the time at the time. But it's a confusing and sort of a downer record just altogether.
Again,
makes me wonder why it's such a draw, and like, because I'm not,
it's
on
so
TikTok.
Moody.
Like, I don't
so
see
moody.
What is the mood on TikTok? What are people swinging around in like in throes of depression? Do they hate
know,
all of
dude.
Their friends on TikTok? What the fuck is going on?
I mean, let me put it to you this way. One of my buddies who's like crazy music nerd, like he's collects so many records and stuff, like he loves music probably even more than I do, and he loves Deftones, like just like we just nerd out about it all the time. He's probably, as far as like friends go, the person that like loves them just as much as I do, and we can talk about it anytime. And I told him that was my favorite record, and he like was like, no fucking way. He's like, I mean, it's a great record, but like, he's like, you know, come on. And I was like, dude, I'm telling you right now, it's a vibe. It's a front to back vibe. You just got to be in the right mood for it to hit you at the right time. But just listen to it front to back at the right setting. Maybe it's at nighttime. Maybe you're just chilling, whatever you're doing. And just like listen to that record and really take it in and just understand that it is a culmination of everything that they had ever wanted to do prior leading up to that. And then also there's like so much distress and like there's so much chaos going on in it, and there's, you could tell, you know, I feel like the self-titled was definitely drenched in sadness, but this was like, okay, we're sad, we're gonna get like spacey, we're gonna get, we're just gonna vibe through this whole thing because we have no idea what's going on. We're just being purely musical, artistic, because we're dissociated from ourselves entirely. So we're just, what we're putting out musically is just gonna be that. We're not even, we're so fucked off, we're not even thinking about what's going on with ourselves. We're just doing this shit. And obviously, you know, the band has said that it's not their favorite to listen to, and for understandably, I bet if any one of us went through that and, you know, recorded a record and it was all put to tape like that, we'd probably be like, yeah, this is hard to listen to. We feel like it's too chaotic. We feel like, you know, going from that to something as tight knit as Diamondize, you know what I mean? But
yeah,
it's, I love it for that, because I think that's what I've always gravitated to Deftones for, is like, they don't give a shit about structures, you know, all the time. They'll do weird shit, you know, they'll try things that people haven't tried. Like, name one record that sounds just like Saturday Night Wrist. There's not even people that have tried to copy Deftones like style, you know, that have like even sounded close to that, at least, you know what I mean? Like,
word.
So it's just, I think it's a moment in time, and it's an album that is just cannot be created ever again. And only the certain right circumstances leading up to it were a part of its creation. And I honestly think that maybe Eros was something similar, and maybe even a branch off into that, like some kind of bridge between, because some of those demos are pretty heavy. So it's like, I'm almost wondering if it was a bridge between Saturday Night Wrist and what Diamond Eyes was. But obviously, after they scrapped that, I think they scrapped so much of the melodramaticness of some of the demos and stuff I've heard from, you know, the shoegaziness and stuff. They were just like, all right, we're just going to write incredible songs, that every single one of these songs could damn near be a single. And they did Diamond Eyes, and it's an insane record, you know?
Yeah, totally. But that's a really interesting take, and I'm totally here for it. Like, yes, yes, keep going. I don't mean to interrupt. I'm just trying to whoop you up. I'm just like, fuck yeah.
I mean, I'm on a rant.
Right on. But you're right on with it, and I'm totally in agreement.
I think that's also why maybe I think I prefer Koi no Yokan over Diamond Eyes, because to me, it's kind of a blend of Saturday Night Wrist and Diamond Eyes.
Word. Yes. And having listened to your interpretation, your understanding of Saturday Night Wrist, and then, yes, I can see that. Yes, totally. Dude, that, yes. Keep going. Go off, kid. Like,
take on it. I don't know. You know, I mean, going back to your question, why do people fuck with it? I don't know. Like I said, my buddy said no way when I told him that, and then he texted me probably like a month later, and he was like, you know what, bro, he's like, I think you might be right about Saturday Night Wrist. And I was like, dude, I'm telling you. He's like, it is a vibe. And I was like, dude, I'm telling you, like, it's Deftones is a pure vibe, and that's what I love about it. It's just purely moody Deftones, whether it's anger, whether it's, you know, drama, whether it's, you know, just trying to be chill, whether it's trying to have fun, whatever, it's everything that they do in one package.
So if they're going to surprise you and play something wild at Dia, is it going to be Kim Dracula, or is it going to be something from Saturday Night Wrist? Let's get a little specific here. What is going to blow your mind out there at Petco?
I mean, really, dude, like, what would blow my mind is like pulling out something like Pink Maggot. I mean, just
come on. But, yes, I mean, of course that would blow my mind. But
I could, that's something.
Is that realistic?
I don't think so. But something that maybe they could pull out. I don't know, because I've seen them play Kim Dracula. The first time I saw them, actually, they played Kim Dracula. Or no, the third time, sorry. The first time I saw them, they played When Boys Telephone Girls, out of nowhere, opening up for Incubus, and I thought that was crazy, because Incubus is like, you know,
15-minute bongo solo. Yeah.
It was like
I like Incubus. Playing, I fuck with Incubus. I'm not trying to hate.
It was like one of those things where it was like they played mostly just their new shit, and then they played like Drive Stellar Part of Me at the end. So it was like, you know, for Deftones to pull out one of debatably their heaviest songs just because of how like gnarly it is, especially live, like with those the keys and stuff, like at full blast. It's like that shit blew my mind, you know. But I don't know, dude. I don't know if necessarily it would be something off Saturday Night Riz, especially with the growing popularity that that's getting now.
Yeah, interesting. And they did sort of bust that nut last year a little bit, right? Because they played a few songs off of Saturday Night Riz last year.
So
I think maybe you're right. Maybe you're right. Okay, so keep going.
I mean, pulling out maybe like Die the Flu. I mean, fuck, you know. I've never seen them play Korea. That would be sick. I don't even know how often they play that anymore. But
yeah.
There's like a handful of things that would definitely surprise me. Royal, love to see that live.
No, I was so mad it didn't Prince. Get pulled out. Yes, Prince would be amazing.
Prince
it would be really interesting to hear some of that Nick Rascalinez stuff, seeing as how they are recording with him or about to record with him. It would be interesting if maybe that was the influence of something on top of that. Oh yeah, maybe let's play some of this shit we did with Nick. Let's play some Koi stuff or some Diamond Eye stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's fun to speculate no matter what.
Oh yeah. I actually wanted to ask you because you kind of asked me, but like how did you get into Deftones and like what do you feel like was the defining moment like when you realized this is my favorite band and like when did your like obsession for them, I guess, to like truly form? Because obviously, I mean, I don't know if it was like this for you, but for me, like when I first heard them, they weren't immediately my favorite band of all time. It took like a little bit of like years of listening experience and stuff. And like, obviously I was pretty young and stuff, but out the gates, they weren't immediately my favorite band. So like, when was the point where you were like, after getting into them, when were you like, okay, I've liked them for, you know, however long, this is what got me into them. And now this is what sealed the deal. Like this band is unfuckwithable in my opinion.
The tables have turned. Question has been reversed. I think I remember. I definitely remember being introduced to Be Quiet and Drive first. And you're right. It took a while before. I think it wasn't until Pony came out and I was working at Circuit City and dudes in the warehouse used to bang Pony like a lot. And they listened to it was probably like Digital Bath or something like that. I was like, what in the fuck is that? That is tight. Like I needed to hear that. And that really probably made me like a fan. And then I think around Self-Titled, it was probably somewhere between Self-Titled and the Team Sleep stuff coming out that I was like full blown. This is my going to college for sure. Cause I started college in 2001. So like I was fully Pony like all the time and a lot of the music of that time. So whether it was Limp Bizkit or the heaviest stuff, and frankly, I loved NSYNC and that shit too. I camped out. I spent the night in a parking lot for tickets to the No Strings Attached tour, just between you and me. I've been about that NSYNC shit. We couldn't just get them online. You had to go wait and buy a hard ass ticket at the grocery store.
yeah. But, which honestly, I kind of missed it, going to record stores to buy tickets, because now it's like,
I know, right?
Yeah.
There's something about going to a record store, a place where music. Yeah. But anyways, but I think it was something about like that being in college, MySpace, or rather Napster was popping. So music was like hot currency, and just being in that environment all the time and listening to Deftones nonstop. That's probably what did it. I don't know if there was ever a moment, but maybe more like a series of moments, going to shows over those years and that sort of thing. I don't even remember for sure what my first Deftones show was. Isn't that kind of sad? I ask people all the time, like, what they're
saying.
I mean, I've been to a bunch, so at this point now, I kind of feel like it's an okay excuse, just because I've been to so many. But I'm not even sure, like, which one was the first one, which is kind of whack. But you remember yours? It was the Incubus, and
it was it was very late in the.
Where was that?
Late,
where did you see
honestly,
him?
Honestly, I was pretty. It was in Mountain View at Shoreline Amphitheater. It was, I can't remember exactly what year it was.
Are you from Sacramento?
Yes. I've lived here my whole life.
I've
lived in Nevada for like a little bit, but I've, you know, born and raised in Sacramento, or like the metropolitan area of it.
Have you ever seen Deftones in Sacramento? I know that you've probably seen them at Aftershock. No?
I've seen him at Aftershock, yes.
But which isn't actually
when
sack,
I was
though,
younger,
right?
I remember they, because there's this thing they do at Cesar Chavez Park here in Sacramento. It's called Country or Concert in the Park. Mm-hmm. They do have Country in the Park, but Concert in the Park, and it's a free concert. It's just they have vendors and stuff. You come through, you don't pay any tickets, you just have to get through security and then you're good. You know, you buy drink tickets, food tickets, whatever, and that's how they make their money.
Cool.
Deftones in like 2006, I believe, played a free concert there. And I remember my brother and I were trying to go, and our dad would not let us go. He didn't have an explanation. He just said, no. I can't remember exactly what occurred, so I don't want to drag him too hard for it, but
but there's a grudge. There's an axe to grind.
I just remember my brother being like, I mean, you know, 2006, like I was 12. He was probably like 14, 15. It was a Friday night, and we're just like, you know, there's a, playing the show for free. He's probably like, I'm not going to drop you off in the middle of Sacramento. Cause we were living like probably like 15, 20 minutes outside of Sacramento at the time. And, he probably just like, I'm not going to drop you off like there with no supervision and have no idea what you're talking about. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So,
all 12 and 14
but
years old.
That would have been a great opportunity. And then after that, it was just kind of missed situations. Like, you know, their Diamond Eyes tour, like I missed because I was actually playing a show in a band at the time. I missed Crosses when they first came through. They were playing at there's this venue called Ace of Spades here. I was like out of town for a family event, I believe. There was like some other Deftones shows that came through, and something was always going on. I never got to see them. And then I saw them finally at that show. I can't remember exactly when it was. I want to say it was like 2012, 2013, somewhere around there.
Yeah.
I don't think Koi had come out yet, but I could be mistaken on that. Could be mistaken on that, but I want to say that was the case. But definitely saw him late in life. I mean, I missed a lot of stuff like from like younger that I look back on. I'm like, damn, I wish I would have seen that, you know. But
I mean, you were like adolescent at that point.
That's
you can't be too hard on yourself. I mean, I was a full,
I should have,
you know,
begged,
18, 19 year old, and I could have gotten some
to
shit,
like, you know. I should have tried
get out
a
the
little
house
harder probably, but I mean, it's
knife to his throat, you're leaving, motherfucker. Come on, we're going right now, we're going out dropping us off that park. I don't care if you're coming back or not.
Oh,
I mean, well, that's 10. So that's 10 years of shows, though. For the past year, past 10 years, there's been certainly at least a few tours and probably a couple random one-offs. So you've seen them a good handful of times.
Yeah, and I've seen them at like Aftershock. I saw them at Knotfest, you know, so there's been stuff like that.
When was the last time? Do you remember the last time that you've seen them?
The last time I saw them was Deftones and Gojira, and
that was that one. Yeah. So you did see them on that last tour.
Yeah.
What was your experience of that show like?
Oh, I mean, I had an incredible time. I mean, I love Vows. It was great being able to see them for the first time. Gojira just destroys, every time I see them play. And then Deftones to top it off, to see them come out to like Genesis and to see like some of those songs, live was just really cool. And then playing Lovers like blew my mind. You know what
Oh,
I
you
mean?
got to
Like,
see Lovers.
I've always felt like if Lucky You and Lovers got swapped, that would be undoubtedly their most probably consistent record.
Word.
But I don't
No
know.
argument here.
But
No argument here.
they played that. They played a couple other ones. Can't exactly have to look at the set list, but I do remember being surprised by like a couple other things. But yeah, it was just like them playing Lovers, that blew my mind,
I
That's one of my
really,
favorite songs from that era.
oh man, for sure. And I totally agree with you. Do you like Lucky You? Do you like that song?
It's all right. I usually find myself more zoning out when it
Yeah.
starts playing, as opposed to like kind of being into it or singing along to it.
Yeah.
It does have a cool sound. I'll give it that. And I do know like what they're going for and stuff. I mean, it's a, it's not as good as everything else on that album, I should say.
Yeah, and I couldn't agree with you more as far as Lovers is concerned. And I'm so jealous that you got to see it. That's the one that I would was really like, I'm totally going to get to see Lovers at
It's
Dia.
insane to me that they were originally going to call the album Lovers and then they scrapped the
Right,
song
the
that
whole
was
thing.
called that. Like the whole concept got scrapped. I'm just like, but leave it to them to just pull some weird shit like that,
Word. Yeah. 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 It's interesting that the albums are so unpredictable, and the live experience generally tends to be one where you can anticipate the way that it's going to move. But what are you thinking about this next album? Is this going to be sort of like the Saturday Night Wrist to Diamond Eyes move, where Ohms is kind of a vibe, and the next album is going to be something that's a little bit more tight up the middle. Let's just hit them with some hitters every time.
I mean, honestly, dude, I kind of think like that already happened with the Gore to Ohms
Really
thing because
interesting.
it's kind of cliche at this point. I've heard a lot of people say like every 10 years they put out a fucking whatever album.
Right.
But like Ohms to me is like them kind of tightening up, but like also fan servicing everything that they've done up until that point. So like you can listen to that record and you'll find something that you enjoy that you would hear easily on every record that they've put out. Urantia, you would hear the opening to that easily on Adrenaline. The beginning of fucking Genesis, you would easily hear on Diamond Eyes or Koi. Some of the spacier stuff, like Ceremony and stuff. Like that almost sounds like if they drew the production back and like kind of chilled out on how powerful the chorus is. I could hear that on Saturday Night Wrist, or not Saturday Night Wrist, sorry, Gore or something. If they kind of made it a little more airy and had that like weird 80s production that they were going for. Like, if
Yeah.
you listen to that record with the thought of the only song I don't know if I could pinpoint would be Ohms itself. That song, when I first heard it, I was like, this is almost unlike, in a weird way, unlike a bunch of stuff that I've heard because it's almost like a reverse. The way he plays, because Steph always does that, like, he does that, like that kind of shit. But like, it's almost reverse of that and played in almost like a rock and roll type way. And it's so interesting, like the way that he does that riff, because it does not sound like to me anything that they would do. It almost sounds like something they would normally do in reverse, but then in a different time signature at the end and stuff like that. That was really cool. Obviously, it becomes very Deftones when it hits. It almost has like the epicness of something like Tempest to me, something very grand sounding, and like I don't know, it's so different to me like than anything else on the record. But like I mean, fuck, but like you got the end of like Spell of Mathematics that like the clapping and snapping, like it almost sounds like there's a clap and a snap going at the same time and it makes this cool effect. And like, I just know that shit live would be insane. And I really hope that's my number one hope is that they play that idea. I don't even care if they played an old
Oh.
deep cut, like if they don't play old deep cuts, whatever. If they could just play that song, because I know that would be incredible live.
Dude, with how many thousand people snapping and clapping, vibing out with their lighters in the air. Ooh, I'm getting
100%.
Goosebumps. I'm getting goosebumps right now. That I couldn't agree more. That's like a number one on the top of my list. Like even above the, you know, the rarities, the lovers or that sort of thing. Like
I'd love to hear like Labia or something, you know, but it's like, I mean, you posted the other day, like I was like, I responded. I was like, they better play this.
They have to. Yeah. You were like, they fucking better.
I'm going to be a little upset if they don't, but
if they don't though, I think, they're going to have to do like a tour or something. Get like, more of those songs need to be played because they can't just go to the next record and not get more ohms out there. Like I feel like that's because they played 3-4 songs at best on the last tour, for 2-3 songs, Genesis for sure, ohms, and then was that it? I think that's all they played on the tour.
That's about it. I want to hear Ceremony. Like I fucking love that song so much. But then it's like, you know, next year, like I also am kind of hoping, obviously they're going to have to do their, I think they're recording right now or something, but you know, maybe they'd pull out some more self-titled stuff. Like I would love to hear Hexagram live. Never heard that live. You know, Needles and Pins. I would love to hear that live. Haven't heard
I
that.
Agree.
Battle Axe. The fact that they played, you know, it's, the fact that they played Lovers is just like insane. And fucking, let me double check this, but yeah, so I'm not, yeah, they played fucking Bloody Cape, which completely blew my mind. They played Beware. It's just, so there were some songs on that set list that I was like, oh shit, you know.
Yeah.
I was really excited that they decided to do that. Even though as much as I'd love to hear more of the Ohm stuff live, hearing Lovers, hearing Bloody Cape, you know.
Yeah, you can't be mad at that.
I cannot be mad at that. I mean, it's just Saturday Night Risks and Self-Titled are probably neck and neck my favorite albums by them.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm sort of hoping that the self-titled stuff makes its way to the forefront at turning 20 this year and everything. At Dia, I'm talking about. But what I'd also like to see is a 2-hour set. That's what I really want. How do we squeeze? Because the question for sure is, okay, you got to play the hits.
Yeah.
You got to play something, out the woodwork. And you have to keep the set moving. And at this point, they've got so many hits. It's hard to squeeze all of those in. And you got to introduce maybe one or two something new. But if you stretch out the set, because it's your own goddamn festival, and you could do whatever you want, and you make that bitch 2 hours long, 2.5, go Pearl Jam, go 3. We are here for that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Play that. That would probably be the thing that would blow my mind beyond anything else.
Yeah. Or do 2 nights a Dia, have more acts, and then do a hit set and do a no hit set where it's all deep cuts.
I'm here for this shit. I feel like we're selling out stadiums at this point. Anything's possible.
Because
you would
pull out people that are like, because I've heard people say like, yeah, I do like seeing Deftones at festivals, but like they just play hits for the most part. Or like, it's like, it's cool, but you know, it's like
an hour.
I only get a handful of surprises. You know, it's like I always enjoy seeing those songs. So like, I mean, you know, you can't go wrong with fucking how insane of a song Digital Bath is, or you know, stuff like that. So it's like I don't mind it. Some people do, but you would get people that are like, oh shit, you know, they're playing fucking, you know, they're playing Die the Flu, and then they're playing Furial, and then they're playing rapture and then combat, you know, like combat would go fucking so hard live, dude. And I don't know why they don't play it.
People would lose their minds. People would lose their minds, especially now in this renaissance of Saturday Night Wrist. It would probably be a major, I mean,
yeah.
Anything, and it's fun to think about two nights that would blow my mind. I would be there. I'm gonna be in San Diego for two nights. Sign me up. Give me that shit. I'm here for that.
Even like playing something like Xerxes live, like that chorus is so massive and nobody fucking talks about it. And it's like, you know, people that didn't even know the song would be singing the shit by the end of the fucking set or by the end of the song. You know, it's like
totally. It's like Cherry Waves in that way. That's that album has. It's got those songs. That's what's up. That's super
I do have another question for you.
All right.
What is your favorite piece of like Deftones lore or like weird little quip maybe about them? If you know what I mean. Like something that's like about them that's like you find intriguing or super just super dope in general.
There are plenty of things that I'm, I guess, curious about.
Well, okay, let's just say maybe something that you know, not something that you're questioning, but maybe something that you know and that you're like, you know, this is one of my biggest reason that this band is so rad.
Wow. That's maybe even an even harder, that might be a harder question. But
I mean, we could dial it back to like just something that you find like really cool about them, I guess, or something that like is just like a little tidbit that you found out one day and you were like, you're just like, fuck yeah, like this is the shit I'm talking about. You know what I mean?
Yeah, sure. I think I do. And honestly, you know, the first thing that comes to mind at this point is sort of what we've been talking about already, this renaissance. Yeah. Like it almost feels in a sense like a validation, like I was fucking right, like I knew they were great, and
like I've been preaching this for years,
you know what I'm saying, like thank you TikTok for fucking validating, because I was the only one that I knew that fucked with Deftones when I was getting into them. Everybody else was kind of like, you know, either my friends were into rap music or they were just like, nah, the screaming is too much for me. Like, I can't do that. I didn't have anybody who was really willing to go that way. Even though some of them would acknowledge like, oh, Digital Bath is a cool song or something like that. They weren't like fans. But now this explosion in popularity, although something that pisses me off about that too, is it seems like there's a lot more gatekeeping. And I fucking hate it when people gatekeep my band. Like, don't fucking do that. Like, let everybody love them. Like,
oh,
I don't
like
give a
people
fuck
are
if,
upset that
you discovered them on TikTok. It's like, who gives a shit? You discovered a fucking welcome to the club.
Yeah, that
you
gives them
I mean?
More money to just keep making records. Like, who fucking cares?
Yeah,
if you
cares?
Like the band, you like the band, you know?
Yeah, totally. Okay, here's something that comes to mind. The Nike Dunks. The Nike Dunks came out in like 03. And that was when I was like going through my dunk thing. And I had all the dunks in the early aughts. Like, you ought to come see me if you needed some dunks, because I had them. Like when shoe culture was still like a budding thing, which sort of sounds whack. And it was impossible. I chased those motherfuckers. Like, I was, every time I went somewhere that there was a possibility that anytime I went to LA, it was like, where I need to go find these shoes. See if let's go hit Rodeo or whatever. I'm trying to find these shoes. Yeah. And the fact that I couldn't ever get them is probably something that only like inflated the like massive, like
it's like the Holy Grail for you.
In a sense.
I mean, fuck, dude. That was me with that Sakto jacket, dude. Like,
word.
It took me 10 years to find that in fucking my size.
Word.
And, like, in a decent condition. And, like, I don't know. Maybe it's the fact that I'm from Sacramento and stuff. It makes it that much better. You know what I mean? But it's
yeah.
That thing fucking, I don't know. I spent a little too much money on it, but I've been hunting it down for, 10 plus years, and I literally check probably once or twice a week, and it popped up and it was like posted 4 hours ago, and I fucking bought it immediately without a thought. I didn't even look at my fucking bank account. I was just like, I don't even care. I'm gonna figure this out because I might not see it again for another 10 years, And
Totally, yeah.
it's a
And it only
very
has been going up in value, especially now that more of their vintage stuff is like vintage priced. I'm like, holy shit,
Yeah.
some of these shirts are $300-$500. I'm like, damn, I wish I would have held that.
Dude, when
That's
they posted
crazy.
that like thing and it was like the teaser for the all those the drops they were doing with that they collabed with, I can't remember the name of
Oh, the Marc
the
Jacobs
Marc
collab?
Jacobs, yeah, correct.
Yeah.
The Heaven collection or whatever.
Yeah.
There's a picture of, I believe, Chino wearing the jacket
Yeah.
in one of them, and I was kind of like, dude, they better not reprint this
I
jacket.
know, right? Yeah.
They better not reprint it.
And they fucking
It's
didn't, and everybody
yeah,
was
they
pissed.
didn't. Dude, I saw even people in the comments like, are you really reprinting that jacket? And like they're like, no, it's just a picture or whatever. So I was like,
People sat on one side of the fence or the other, like, you better not reprint that motherfucker jacket, or please God, remake
Yeah,
that
no, I mean
jacket
that's
again,
how I was for 10 years, dude. I was looking for that fucking thing and I finally found it and it worked out. But
how is it today? Is it still looking good? Still in good
oh, it's
shape?
still looking great.
You still
Yeah.
rock it?
Still looks amazing.
That fucking rules. I have the red one, and I probably went
Yeah,
through a
dude.
similar thing
I'll show
with
you right now.
do you fucking, yeah, get it out, whip it out. Oh yeah, there she
Look at
is.
that, dude.
That is in great shape.
No flaking or anything.
That is in great shape.
Yeah, it's incredible. So it's like it's held up,
Don't wear that in my hood. Run that jacket, homie.
But yeah, so that was definitely probably
Is that your most prized Deftones possession, piece of memorabilia?
I would say so, yeah. I would have to say I would say that's probably, my most prized possession just because how long it took me to find it, says Sacto on it, which is cool because that's also something only people from Sacramento say for the
Word.
most part, so it's like it just kind of has that sentimental value. It reminds me of like that time where it's like obviously I was kind of growing up and hearing them, and then like people that I talk to that are older, like I work at a music venue as a stagehand, and like the lighting director, like he's just told me all these stories. He's worked with, Sean from Crosses and stuff. Like he's, one of the guy that hired me at the venue. He's been one of my good friends for years. Like he's, done stuff like with Deftones, and like he's been inside their spot, and like he's, it's just all these stories and stuff that I hear. It's just crazy, like legends and stuff that I hear. And I'm like, dude, I wish I was just coming up at that time, like when the Cattle Club was a thing and like they were playing, they debuted Be Quiet and Drive in My Own Summer at the Press Club. And I don't know, like you if you ever go into the Press Club, it's the smallest venue, probably. It's one of the smallest venues in Sac. It's crazy, and it's like it's just insane to me to think that they were just like a local band that was playing almost every week. And like, I'm so jealous of people. And I just get fucking stars in my eyes when people that grew up in the Sacramento scene and stuff, like they'll show me all this dope shit that they have from like the times when they would just see him for $5 at the door. You know what I mean? And like, they just had all this shit and they're just like, yeah, dude. And they have pictures with them and stuff. And like, even just as surreal as like seeing people like Frank and Abe like chilling down at like the bars and stuff, like they frequent that stuff and just seeing them down there, seeing him at local shows randomly, like it's super cool because it makes it more surreal like how local they are to me, I guess, and like how much of an impact they had like on our scene. And like, because when I started really getting into them, they were already fucking superstars, basically in like the realm of like they were touring, they were, doing all this thing. And like in my eyes, like anybody that was putting out records was just the biggest thing ever, so it was like it was insane to me that they were from Sacramento, I guess. And I just really looked up to that, you know, and always have.
You see him at shows and stuff. You ever have you ever had a run-in, like a direct run-in, or met Frank
yeah,
or
I've, like,
Abe at
I've,
a
like,
bar?
talked to him. I've
Have
talked
you?
to him, like, briefly, just said, like, what's up? You know, I don't,
Yeah.
I try not to, like, fangirl with people too hard, you know, like,
Good for
I
you.
just, I know what it's like for people, you know, and I know, like, you know, I mean, in musician terms, they call it getting punished, you know, they're like, oh, that guy punished you so hard and stuff. Like, you know, I talk to bands and stuff, like, working with them all the time in a music venue, like, and it's just, I don't know. I'll try to say, like, just a couple words. I'm like, hey, man, love your music. Just want to throw that out there. Like, appreciate it, you know. And then
Yeah.
if they initiate a conversation after that, then I'll sit there and talk to them. But, like, that's kind of where I leave it. And if sometimes they'll be like, yeah, dude, what's your name? And, like, they'll chat you up and stuff. And, like, then you know they want to talk. But if they don't want to talk, they'll be like, thank you, you know, blah, blah, blah. And then so it's like, I just kind of throw them, like, my compliment, know that I did that, and it's all good. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think the
Yeah.
only person that I haven't met out of the band is probably Chino, but think he lives in, like, Oregon or whatever, so I don't know why I would see him.
Yeah.
But yeah, so
Well, you might fucking run into him at Dia. It feels like every year that I've been, I've either had a close encounter, like a near miss, or like,
yeah.
you know what I mean, like a near
He's
encounter.
elusive. He's
Yeah,
elusive.
yeah, yeah. But out there, I mean, he brought his mom out to get tacos the last time I had like VIP or whatever, like. He brought his
Yeah.
mom out to get tacos and
Yeah.
everybody
I
bum rushed
mean,
him. Everybody punished the shit out of him, but he was down. You know what I mean?
I've had, like, I was working one night, and my buddy who works at this restaurant here called the Casbah, and this was, like, years ago or whatever. I want to say this was, like, around the time, like, Koi, like, came out or whatever, but he was my roommate, and he just sends me a picture of, like, Chino and his whole entourage at Casbah. And he
Wow.
was, and, like, he's, like, took a picture with him, and then he's like, haha, like, blah, blah, blah. I was like, fuck you, dude. And he just knew what he was doing. I mean, same thing, like, my buddy did merch for Crosses when they came through to Ace of Spades, and he knew I was out of town. He knew how much I loved, you know, Deftones, Team Sleep, Crosses. Like, he knew I was a fan of Chino and stuff. And he was just like, fuck you, bro. He's, like, taking pictures, like, kicking it with him, like, backstage and shit. And I'm like, you piece of shit. You know what I mean? Like, you can't
Got
even
your
get.
shirt. Just kidding.
And,
Didn't
like,
get your
neither one of
shirt.
these people, like, even got me a signature, fucking at least something, you know? Like, I'm like, you didn't get me at least that after you fucking, you know,
Hey, fuck
just
those
talked all that
guys.
shit.
Fuck those
Yeah. I mean, they're,
guys.
you
Not friends. Not
know.
friends. Blacklisted.
But yeah, no, it was, there's just, you know,
Are you going to
yeah.
any of the Crosses stuff that's
Yeah.
coming up? You
Yeah.
are? You got a
So,
ticket to the Cross? Oh.
yeah. At the chapel in SF, which I've never been to the venue, but I looked up pictures of it, and it looks fucking wild. I don't know. Like, look
Word.
up pictures of that venue.
Really?
It looks crazy.
Yeah.
Like, I'll just pull it up, because it literally,
The
I just can't
chapel in
imagine.
San Francisco.
Yeah. So here's, I don't know if you can see that, but, like, it's just this crazy illuminated, like, perfect thing. And
That's
it's like, I'm
sick.
pretty sure it's like a 1,000 cap venue or something. It's not like,
No,
so the
it's
first,
small. It
it's
doesn't
small.
look small at all.
It's like, I think it's a little over 1,000. I remember Googling it to try and,
That's
because the first
badass.
day it sold out. I was waiting from 9:30 to 10 a.m. when the things dropped. I
Yeah.
didn't get tickets first day. Second day, I called my dad, and I was like, yo, can you log into my account on this shit with my card? And, like, I was like, we need to both be refreshing this shit. And he actually didn't get it, and I got tickets. And he was on there, like, same time as me. Like, it was just by chance, dude. And, like, they went fucking, because they went so quick the first day, there was no chance. And then, like, people were pissed off in the comments and stuff. So they opened a second day to, like, be ready at 10 a.m. tomorrow. So I called my dad at, like, 8 in the morning. I was like, can you do me a huge favor? Like, be ready at fucking 9:45 and just be hitting that refresh button, because I'm gonna be doing the same, and I need these tickets. And
Hell yeah.
he's like, Crosses, is that some kind of, like, religious, like, Christian band? And I was like, No, I don't.
But you're
think
going
so.
to see them at a church.
Yeah, he's like, you're seeing crosses at the chapel. He's like, is this some super Christian band? I was like, no. I was like, that's hella funny though. But
that is super funny. The venue looks tight as hell.
Oh, dude,
it's really
yeah.
exciting, especially for a crosses show. I feel like that's
going to be intimate.
Yeah, that setting befits.
Because I'm seeing them at Darker Waves, that like New Wave Festival.
Oh, you are going to Darker Waves too?
Oh, yeah. Oh. Fuck yeah. B-52s, New Order, Tears for Fears. It's going to be fucking sick.
Yeah.
But Crosses is playing like mid-level, maybe lower mid-level. Like they're probably only going to get like, you know, 35, 40-minute set. It is dope. It's going to be in Huntington Beach on the beach. So that should be interesting.
Yeah.
And then obviously a lot also, I mean, that lineup is so incredibly stacked. Like,
oh my God, that lineup is insane.
Oh
yeah.
Dude. Yeah. Like New Order,
TSOL, like
band,
everybody's.
So,
yeah. Yeah. There's a, there's so, top to bottom. That is an insane.
Drab
lineup.
Majesty. Like love them. It's just going to be incredible. But yeah. I mean, speaking of crosses, I kind of wanted, so when I was like talking about like kind of like something like one of your favorite quips or something, it kind of made me think about like, because obviously, you know, there's stuff that blows my mind, like the fact that Chino wrote Digital Bath in like 30 minutes in like a closet or a bathroom or whatever, and then he just took it to the studio at like 2 a.m. or whatever he said, and then he was like blasting it on the way back in the car or whatever, and he was like, could be remembering that part of it a little bit wrong, but like I do remember him saying, you know, that and this, that kind of stuff, you know, like, or him hearing the My Own Summer riff and then like they turn that into a song, or my Diamond Eyes being written in a month, you know, stuff like that. So it's like that kind of, those kind of quips like always blow my mind. But like the Saturday Night Wrist tumultuous like recording process to Crosses Pipeline is insane. So obviously, you know, the issues with like the vocal recordings for Saturday Night Wrist, I believe they went to two different producers, two or three or something. And, you know, one of the dudes told Chino, like, you can't sing. And it made him question himself. That's why he kind of went off on his own thing. And he straight up said, like, he doesn't have the, you know, he kind of made him lose confidence in himself and stuff. And he just kind of dived deeper into whatever. And, but then he was telling, because I believe Sean mentioned it, you know, he's telling him like at a party or some shit, like, let me do your fucking vocals, I'll do it better or whatever. And he was like, yeah, you're going to do these vocals. And then they did it. And he was like, I can't believe I'm doing this dude's vocals right now.
Right.
You know? And then they did it. And then I think like from that, because I just listened to a podcast recently that actually just came out. He was talking about how they asked about his, you know, their history and how long they wanted to work with each other. And they were like, yeah, I mean, you know, 20, 30 years ago, like we mentioned working with each other and stuff, you know, making some like DJ Shadow type shit or like whatever, but like, you know, it didn't happen for so long. And I just feel like that Saturday Night Wrist thing happening, them working together, because I feel like Chino also, if I'm not mistaken, I believe he said that he just feels most comfortable recording in his studio with him, and like they just work so well together that I believe that that specifically happening at the Saturday Night Wrist thing is kind of what blossomed into the whole Crosses thing. Chino recording with him and being like, oh, this is what it's like to record with this dude, like, fuck yeah, let's go. And then once after, you know, Diamond Eyes and all that kind of stuff, you know, kind of settled down, he's like, dude, let's, I don't know, I'd like to imagine he was like, dude, let's do some more shit. And then they did, they started dropping the little mini EPs for Crosses, and then, you know, did the fucking full album and stuff. So I believe there's a very strong connection between those two instances, but I could be wrong. But I mean,
it's really interesting to think about the, like the trauma of that time basically resulting in this.
Yeah. It led him into a
partnership
situation.
And like you said, the comfort level that he has with Sean now, and Sean seemingly having like this magic touch with, or whatever, the space that he's created that has allowed him to be so prolific. Like the Crosses stuff is coming out at a high clip. Like they have put out twice as much music as Deftones have in the past couple of years, right? Like, lot of music.
I feel like, I mean, Chino's
on top of all the features,
even said recently that he feels the most productive that he's felt ever. I mean, it's also funny to me because his dynamic with Sean almost seems like the exact opposite dynamic he has with like Steph, where it's like they have this. I mean, obviously the whole tension thing's overblown, you know, whatever, but they do have this like, let's outdo each other. I don't like that. Let's make it better. Or you don't like this, you know, then you make it better. Whatever it seems to be.
Mm-hmm.
With Sean and Chino, it seems to be this whole, they just kind of know what's going on, whether or not each other's going to feel something, or if they're not feeling something, then they just can vibe that. And they don't seem to really have any tension behind what they're doing. They just kind of know where it needs to go, how the song needs to fit each other's, you know, needs and stuff. So,
I don't know.
I think it's kind of cool that there's two different dynamics, it seems. And I think it produces different results, but equally amazing.
Yeah. Is Chino your favorite musician?
I would say he's my favorite vocalist for sure. Probably just because of like, you know, obviously writing stuff like Digital Bath, there's a lot of, you can hear his guitar in a lot of things. And I do like the way he kind of floats over what Stefan's doing. And there's even some parts that he's written that are kind of heavy, you know,
for sure.
If you really look into it, like there's some riffs that he wrote that are heavy songs. There's even entire songs from what I understand. Like, so it's not that he's just like, just the melodic guy, you know what I mean? But I don't know about musician, but I would say for sure vocalist, just because he encompasses everything that I enjoy about vocals. I like his looseness. I like his, he doesn't care, like attitude about it. You know, it's like every time I see them live, I can see the same song 10 times and it will sound different every time. He will sing it slightly different. Yeah. He just kind of floats and vibes over the track. And that's really what his whole thing is. And that's what music's all about at the end of the day. Yes, you can get technically perfect about it. You can get, you know, dive into the theory of everything. You can get so precise about what music should sound like. But then it's like at the end of the day, when you dive too far into that, like, does it truly move you? There's music where it's kind of out of tune, but it moves me much more than something that is produced so nicely. And it's, you know, it's so just perfect and fucking, you know what I mean? Like nothing's out of tune, nothing's out of pitch. Just everything is exactly, it's almost mathematical, you know?
Totally.
And I just, their rawness and they just don't give a shit, you know? And I just love it. And you can feel that live. You can feel that they're enjoying themselves. And hearing that on the record and live, you can hear that they're into what they're doing and that they believe in what they're doing. And I think that's what I like most about music and vocals. I mean, that's probably my reasoning for that, I would say.
Do you lament the fact that Chino doesn't rap anymore? Because I do. I mean, if he's the greatest vocalist of all time, and yet he's got this tool in the toolbox, I'm just fucking around. I know nobody really cares if he doesn't rap. I'm the only one.
It would be
I'm
sick.
I'm like a one-man army. I'm like, bro, just drop
it. It would be sick if they fucking, if like, because you know Sean's got some beats, like, for days. Like,
he's got a beat.
Bro, imagine if he slapped some crazy beats down and fucking Chino just went off. I mean, that would be sick. But
somebody who said that they heard in advance of the new Crosses record, and I was like, oh shit, because LP after the track listing came out or whatever, and LP was on, I was like, does Chino rap on it? Was my first question. He was like, I don't think so, and I was like, fuck. But it's the time. I'm not really tripping, but it would blow my mind.
It'd be sick, dude. You know, he comes out under some like rap fucking moniker and he's just got like, he just drops a mixtape out of nowhere.
Oh man, that would be crazy. I don't think that's gonna happen, but there's damn near plenty of beats that I've heard that
I also didn't think crosses was gonna happen, but look at this shit. It's fucking incredible. Like, you know, some of the crazy shit, like the beat and like invisible hand, like how insanely clipped that bass hit is. And it's like, I would have never thought I'd hear Chino on something like that, but like, I fucking love it. You know what I mean? Like, and these last two singles, like Ghost Ride and Light as a Feather, like, just.
It's pretty wild how like across the board they are. Like they're not like at all. It's really going to be interesting to see how the entire album comes together. Like, is it just wild songs like this that are all over the place? Like, what is the connecting string? You know what I mean? And that you mentioned Invisible Hand, like a song that's got the whole kitchen sink thrown into it and yet doesn't feel like it's doing too much. It feels like it's doing just what it's supposed to do. It's like, shit,
I feel like every time I play that song, it cuts my fucking, it cuts years off my sub's life. 100%. I totally hear it.
Yeah,
it's fucking,
Sean's
it's
got
though.
Some he's doing some wild shit. Sean's doing, he's cooking, and I feel like,
oh dude, he's the chef.
There's like still levels that he has to go, I feel like, too. You know what I mean? Like there's
he's whipping it up nonstop, and he's only getting better production, and it's beautiful. I just love to see it.
I wonder if he's done any hip hop production. I wonder if he's done anything for, because I know he's done, like he's doing some production for Fever 333, and he's like produced some other artists and stuff. But I wonder, like, has he made, what are the, I would love to hear a straight up like hip hop beat from Sean, or like hear him flip a sample or something. That'd be some wild shit.
I agree. I mean, fuck, that'd be so sick.
Yeah, especially if Chino's gonna rap on it. Fuck yeah, that'd be tight.
Oh yeah.
I was gonna ask you a question. Have you and because I know you're tattooing as well.
Yes.
Have you thrown any Deftones ink on anybody yet?
Yes, I have actually.
What have you tattooed?
I've actually done 3 white ponies.
Get the fuck out of here. You've done 3 ponies?
Yeah. My first tattoo ever was a white pony on my brother. And then I've done another outline of a white pony. And then I did a white pony with some like basically the self-titled like skull and like roses on the inside of it.
Word, you fit the skull and roses inside the pony? That's hard. I like the just the simple.
I mean, it's
definitely clean.
Very like.
That's tough.
Yeah. It's very like, it was an early tattoo and stuff. You know, it's very minimal, I guess, with it, but the idea is there. But yeah, it's super, super fucking. I mean, anytime I get to do something like that, I'm just.
Do you have one? Do you have a Deftones tattoo?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. What's your Deftones tattoo?
It's a white pony with blue and red roses in it.
You got the pony too?
Yeah, and then I have a koi fish on my foot that actually says "Koi no Yokan" in a kanji across my toes.
That's tight.
I mean. That's as far as that goes. Yeah, that's all I would say. Like, as far as like Deftones influenced tattoos. But yeah.
That's hard. Well, the way I like to conclude every podcast is with a request for recommendations. As you know, this is inspired by something Chino said on a podcast, that the reason that he shares links to music I don't even know if he does it on Twitter or X anymore, but that's what he was into for a minute. I might need to come up with a new closing question. But in that spirit, can you put me on to 3 things? Give me some recommendations for literally anything in the world that you think people should get into or check out, spend a little time with.
Of course. So I mean, first thing, I don't know. I guess this is like kind of something that like, I mean, this is something that like, I feel like I need to listen to with like my own advice and kind of something I've been getting into more like lately. But I think putting like who you are and like what you're into and like everything in your head, put it outside of your head. And like, what I mean by that is like, that doesn't necessarily have to be publicly, doesn't necessarily have to be privately, but just like little things, like whether it's like, you know, I like to like write poetically, or like I like to sketch, you know, doesn't matter if it's gonna suck, doesn't matter if it's gonna sound stupid, just get your thoughts out there, you know, or just kind of put who you are, like dress however you want, look how you want, feel how you want inside. Like, don't worry about like what people think, because at the end of the day, like, you're going to feel a lot better just kind of being your true self, you know, like, don't be afraid to start a business that you want to start. Like, just try it, go for it. If you fail, then you fail, but at least you tried, you know. Don't be afraid to write that song. Don't be afraid to whatever it may be, you know, just if that's what you've been thinking inside, because I talk to people all the time that are like, man, I really wish I could do this. Or it's so cool that you're like, learn, you know, you're doing tattoos and, you know, you work at a music venue and stuff. And those are your two favorite things and stuff. And I'm like, yeah, I mean, it's, but it was like intimidating kind of at first, you know what I mean? And it's, but it's like all in my, all I can do is try, you know? And I think somebody else, I believe one of your last guests talked about meditation. So I'm not going to talk too much about that, but I will say that meditating first and then maybe doing something like working towards a little goal, you know, maybe writing a part of a song or just doing whatever work, brainstorming your thoughts on what you want to do creatively. Say you want to make things, say you want to, you know, be a radio personality or whatever, like meditate a little bit. And then you, it will help you come into a clear focus, and then you won't feel so overwhelmed with the idea of it, and you'll be much more calm in general. And then you just try, you know, just do the research of what you got to do and just like put it out there and just put the effort in and try. And you'd be very surprised at how far you can get just doing that kind of stuff. Like, I never thought I would be doing tattoos or anything. Like 4 years ago, I never thought I would be working at a music venue, you know, even 2 years ago. But it's like, I just put it out there. I asked, I tried, I, you know, and I've been doing the work since, and here I am, you know, and like, I'm making a career out of it. And if I fail, then I fail, but that's not the plan. And I'm just going to keep trying. But yeah, I think meditation with an intention afterwards, I think can help a lot, because I think society's pressures and stuff like that makes everybody's head so noisy that they think everything's so overwhelming. And I struggle with that too. So I completely understand.
That's tight.
Second one, I would just say, like, I mean, this comes from probably like working in a music venue more, but like even just in general going to shows, like, check out artists that like you don't really listen to live. Just watch them. Even if you like, you see, like, say maybe you go to a show and like the headlining band's all you care about, and you want to stand outside in the smoking section or at the bar and not really listen, like, just watch the bands, you know. And like, you'd be very surprised at how good some of these bands are, or artists or whatever. And I think working in a music venue, like, I'll work shows with people that I've never even heard of in my life. And then like, I'll, you know, I'll watch the show and it's sold out. And I'm like, oh, like, okay, like there's a lot of people into this, you know? And I'm, even if it's not sold out, like, I'll just be like, you know, let's just watch this. And I'd say 9 times out of 10, I'm pretty blown away by some of the stuff that I see. And it's just, you never know what you're going to get. It could be anything from, you know, an R&B thing to an indie thing to some, you know, DJ type thing to like reggae. You never know, dude. And I'm constantly getting, you know, thrown a curveball, I feel, honestly, like just checking out these musicians. And then they gained me as a fan just because I sat there and watched them and I gave them the time of day with an open mind. And I'm just learning about new artists all the time. And it's super cool. And seeing them in their live setting, doing what they're meaning to do with their production or whatever that they, how they want to present themselves, I think is a part of that. And I think that's better than just clicking on random things on Spotify or whatever, trying to find new artists. Like, if you watch something live, it will completely change your perspective on something and make you have a bigger appreciation for live music in general.
Totally.
So I love that. It's very important.
I love that.
And then third thing, if any of y'all ever find your way to Sacramento, let me do a Deftones tat on you.
Fuck yeah. I'm in there. I'm going. I got to make the journey to Mecca at some point. It's for sure going to happen.
Oh, dude, you know I got you, dude. Let's do it.
I'm in there for sure.
Jeremiah Kima, my dog. I'm stoked to connect this weekend to Dia. Thank you for listening to this podcast and contributing to the conversation and for being curious and patient and kind. Will you marry me? JK, not a polygamist. If you're a Dia this weekend, don't be afraid to hit me up. I'm at Woodbra on Instagram and X, I guess. Hardly check that shit anymore, though. Hit me on Instagram. Happy Dia de los Deftones. And thank you for listening to Change in the House of Pods.